And that's the title of my message today. The title of the message today is Increase My Faith, Lord. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. Amen, is what the Word of God says. But to have faith, you know what I mean? Like everybody looks for a youth ministry. You know, when it comes to deciding, you know what church we're going to go to? Do they got something for the children? Do they got something for the youth? Because if they ain't got a youth ministry or a children's ministry, we ain't going. We just going to go down to the church down the street. You know what I mean? And it puzzles my mind because, you know what? We settle for things that are, you know, more pleasing to our flesh. You know, and we don't want to do the things that are harder. You know, we got to think right. And we got to keep thinking right. This is key to our relationship and serving God and being filled with the Holy Spirit and being able to increase our faith. For the Lord to increase our faith, we got to think right and we got to keep thinking right. You know, it's one thing to start off on the right track, but then it's another thing, you know what, then to go way left, you know what I mean, or just to stop all of a sudden. You know, how many of us, it's kind of like my old car sometimes when it gets real hot, those old gas pumpers, man, you get them out there in them 90-degree weathers, and you're sitting out there at a stop. You don't want to sit there. Why? Because, man, that gas gets hot, and all of a sudden, man, your car starts acting up, and it wants to die out. It starts choking. Stop, blah, 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 blah. And you're like, ooh, hurry up. I got to get going. Man, I'm going to call a tow truck, and then your honey's over there. Man, I told you about these dumb cars. There ain't nothing wrong with the car, honey. It's okay. You got to think right. Amen. You got to think right and you got to keep thinking right. It's going to get us to where we need to go. Amen. But it's in that time of that heat and in that mixture that things begin to bubble. Amen. And that vapor. A brother was talking to me about the atmosphere. Amen. With fireworks. You know, it seems like, you know what I mean? It's in the middle of that when that things are about ready to blow up, that chaos is erupting in there. Same thing in our life. You know, if we allow that area, that middle area of our faith, you know what, to go wavered, instead of continuing to think positive, what's going to happen? We're going to burn out, church. Go with me to 3 John verse 2 this morning. 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, there we are. Amen. Beloved, I'm reading out of the New King James Version. It says, Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things. How many hating Christians do we have? A lot. Man, they see a brother doing good, man, and instead of praying that the brother's prospering, man, he's got to be selling dope again. Man, that's the word in my neighborhood sometimes, man. You got people that knew me from the past, and they pass by my house, and they're like, man, pastor's up to no good. Have you seen all the toys at pastor's house? If they only knew that I'm having to sell off half of my toys just to be able to keep going. But praise God. But instead of praying for the best of people, to prosper them, you know what? And I'm not even talking in the physical church. I'm talking in the supernatural. This is where we have to separate ourselves as Christians. You know, we see so many things on the surface in the physical that we forget the God that we serve is supernatural and that he fills us with the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is supernatural. But instead of focusing on the spiritual realm, we're more focused on the natural. And God don't operate like that. My beloved, you know what? I'm praying for my beloved. I'm praying. You know what? I'm praying for them. Why? That they prosper. Man, Lord, I see that fire that you've placed inside that brother, man. He don't look at me the same. He's got like a zeal inside of his eyes that, you know what? He desires more of you, man. I can't believe that he's beating me to church, God. Praise God. Give him the ump to even get there even more earlier, Lord God, to encourage the saints to do the same thing, that he would prosper spiritually. You know what, Lord? Give him a hunger and a desire for that word. Why? Because I could see that word prospering in his life. Why? Because he ain't the same person that he was when he walked through them doors a few months ago. Prosper him, Lord. And he goes on to say, to prosper in all things and to be in health, just as your soul prospers. to be in health. You know, I want you to write something at the end of that. I want you to write hashtag poverty mentality. Now what happens is a lot of times Christians have this poverty mentality. It says, just as your soul prospers. You know, we have to stop shrinking everything down to our level. And see, we have to understand that we serve an awesome God and a mighty God. See, we put limits on God. When it comes to the Word of God, we shrink His Word. You know, His Word tells us, you know what, that we can do all things through Christ Jesus. But yet we tell ourselves, and the devil lies to us, and that says we can only do some things. Who told you that you can only do some things? You know what? Stop letting the enemy lie to you. He lied to Eve in the garden by filling her with a whole bunch of ifs. Well, if God told you this and if God told you that, and you begin to question, amen, the things of God, you begin to loosen your grip upon faith. You know, one thing that you can't do is let go of your grip. Once you get a hold of it, you got to grab onto it like never before, church. See, we got to know that the God that we serve is without limits. A God who can do the impossible. Man, the God that we serve is a God that has no limits. Man, look what He did for you. Look what He did for me. Look what He's doing for people out there that we don't even know, just strangers that we've heard their testimony. The God that we serve has no limits. He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. But we can't lower ourselves to this thinking, church. We got to be filled with faith. You know what, Lord, fill me with a faith, an increasing faith. I need faith, Lord, faith like never before. I need a faith, Lord God, to keep me going. We must allow God to get rid of the negative mindset in order for Him to expand our thinking. How many of us, you know what, we're simpletons, right? I am. I didn't even want to go to school. I dropped out. I got my GED, I mean my GED. Amen. But I always wanted to settle for the simple things in life. You know what? I wanted to always take the easy route. I wanted the fast money. You know what? I wanted the quick get-rich schemes. You know what I mean? That's what I wanted. But that ain't the way it is with the Lord. You know what? The Lord wants to expand your mind, church. You know what? Are you tired of this? You know what? Thinking that this is how you're going to be for the rest of your life? You know what? That's a poor man mentality. You know what? That's a stinking thinking mentality. You know what? That's that old man mentality. You know what? We need to ask God to increase our faith and to expand our minds so that way we can really begin to see who we are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because when we begin to really believe that, then we'll believe that we can do all things through Christ Jesus who gives us the strength. Amen? Amen. Praise God. There's something that we must be aware of in order to see the way God intends us to see. We got to be aware of it. In verse 2, He tells us here, He says, the word of soul. Let's go back to the beginning here, brother. Okay, go back again to verse 2. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. Now, soul has two different meanings. You know, pneumo is, you know, or the spirit. But the one that I want to talk about today is the mind or the will or the emotion. And this is what I want to look at today. The mind. Faith. Do you know that your mind and your heart are connected? Your mind and your heart are connected. You know what? And you got to learn, amen, to begin to be filled with this faith. A faith like never before. The word soul, that's what it means. It has two meanings. You got to understand that. The inside person, you know what? But it also has to deal with the emotional person. How many of you know that most of us are defeated by our emotions? Man, we're our own worst enemy. Instead of having faith, we talk ourselves out of it. You know, the enemy just, you know, speaks the word. He says, if. And then we let the role play go on. If what? If this, if that. Oh, no, I can't do that. Oh, man. I can't be faithful. I can't be committed. Oh, I can't do that. Yes, you can. You know what? Stop listening to yourself and stop listening to the enemy and start listening to God. Go with me to Proverbs 23, verse 7. Hallelujah. Are you with me this morning, church? Proverbs 23:7 says, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Now, what do you think of yourself? Have you ever thought about what these young people think of themselves? Man, these young people think that they're never going to amount to their full potential. Why? Because there's somebody always in there, you know what I mean, trying to show themselves bigger and badder, you know, that has more money, more flashy, more classy. So every time that you look into social media or every time you try to look on one of these things, you know where you're trying to live up to a persona that you're never going to be able to match up to. And he says, and for as he thinks in his heart, so he is. And we wonder why, you know what I mean, in the times that we're living in, you know what I mean, a lot of times, you know what, that a lot of people, they don't think, you know what, too good of themselves. The Bible says not to think too highly of yourself. Didn't say not to think good of yourself. See, highly is different. Highly is puffing yourself up. Highly is being, you know what, a snob-nosed, inconsiderate fool. But right here, you know what I mean? For as he thinks in his heart, so he is. What do you think of yourself, church? I remember when I was growing up, the things that people said about me, you know what I mean? And I ended up, you know what I mean, living that type of life. Why? Because that's what I believed in my heart. I believed in my heart that I could never be good. I believed in my heart that, you know what, that I would never amount to anything because that's what everybody was speaking to me. So that's what I believed in my heart. My grandma every once in a while would tell me about the word of God. You know what? Jesus died for you on the cross, he thought, but you know what? I didn't believe it. Why? Because it was so far from my heart because it was the things that I wasn't hearing. I didn't have that faith that I needed. You know, we have faith in ourselves and we have faith in the world, but yeah, you know what? When it comes to standing, we need to have faith in God. We need to have faith in God. You know, in order to move forward, we must think on another level. How many of you are stuck in that thinking, you know what, that everything's all good right now. You know what, I don't drink no more. I don't do drugs no more. You know what, I'm working, you know what, and I'm doing all right. I come to church, you know, and I go to prayer every once in a while, you know, and everything's good. And you think you're okay. In your heart, you believe that that's okay, but it's not. You know why? Because you're sitting on a plain level. You know what? God doesn't want you to be right here. God wants you to keep on growing. He wants you to go from glory to glory. He wants you to increase your faith on a daily basis. Amen. Now, that's right, brother. Amen. Not only are we living in a generation, you know what, where they don't want no rules, no laws. You know what? They don't want to follow anything. You know what? But we're living in a faithless generation as well. Man, kids don't believe in Santa Claus no more. Praise God, you get two presents. No, but you know, for us that know that, you know, that, you know, I don't want to ruin that for some families, you know what I mean? We know the truth. You know, we don't celebrate a lot of those things. We celebrate, you know what I mean? We celebrate Christmas because, you know, that's when Jesus was born. That's the day we serve it. That's what we celebrate it for. You know what, people don't understand, you know what, the significance of a Christmas tree and the ornaments and all that. You know what, Jesus was that precious gift that was underneath that tree that we're unable to wrap, amen? And not only that, those ornaments. Why? Because people were bringing gifts to the Savior. Gifts to a Savior. And what is a tree? A tree's made to be adorned. Who adorned the Savior? They adorned him. They covered him in gifts. And how many of us are covering the Lord in gifts? Those gifts that he's given us. You know what, Lord? You gave me a gift to be able to talk, so I'm doing it for your glory and for your honor. You gave me a gift of mechanics. You gave me a gift of electrical work. You gave me a gift of this, a gift of that, of playing music. Whatever that gift is, you know what? I'm doing it for you, Lord God. I'm adorning you. And that's what we got to do. But we got to be ready to go to another level. And what I mean by this of another level is a spiritual level. We have to start believing in the impossible. In the impossible. Church, we got to start believing in the impossible. You know, our boss tells us, you know what, there ain't no overtime. Yes, there is. You want me to tell you how this comes to truth in life? I used to tell everybody when I was working, when I was able to, and I'll be able to work here soon again, hopefully in the name of Jesus. They say, absolutely no overtime. And I said, anybody that works for my crew gets all the overtime they want. I was the only crew all year that ran overtime. Amen. Why? Because they could believe whatever they want. You know what? God knows what I need. Amen. And if God knows I need that overtime, guess what? God's going to give me that overtime. Not because I want it, but because I need it. See, so many people want it so that they can spend whatever they have on their wants. But you know what? When God knows what you need, he's going to give you what you need so that way it can increase your faith. You know, I believe in the impossible. Man, I was like, man, I was thinking, you know, before, you know, I don't know if I'm ever going to come back from this. You know what I mean? If I'm ever going to be the same. I said, you know what, devil, you're a liar. I don't want to hear about the ifs. You know what? My leg bends the same as the other leg, and I still got 3 metal plates in it and 22 screws, and it still bends the same as the other leg. You know what? That's faith, because God is faithful. You know, they're going to call me Robo-Cholo now, but that's all good. You know, I don't care. It's all good. I'm going to keep going in faith. Amen? Because I believe in the impossible. You know what? When my wife told me, you know, when I was out there in the world and she started serving the Lord, she says, you know what? You deserve better than this. You know what? I'm going to file for divorce, taking me and the kids, and we're gone. You know what? I don't want to hear about the ifs, devil. You know what? I've come too far in the name of Jesus, and I believe in the impossible. God, you can restore this marriage. After I done jacked it all up, Lord, you can restore it. Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. And I like to be honest. Why? Because I'm the tonto in the marriage, man. I'm the one who jacks everything up, man. I'm the one who questions, man. I'm the one who fights. My wife's the one that tries to keep me in line. Praise God. I could admit it. Do you know that God has a promised land lifestyle for every area of our lives? You didn't hear me in here today, church, did you? Do you know that God has a promised land lifestyle for every area of your lives? You know that he has a promised land lifestyle for your marriage? A marriage that's in abundance, man. A marriage that's, you know, complete, that has everything that it needs. You know that he has a promised land lifestyle for your teenagers and for your young kids. You know that he got a promised land lifestyle not only for this church. You know that he has a promised land lifestyle for every area of our life. But are we going to grasp it with faith, church? You know, it's a land of abundance. That's what the promised land is. It's a land, of days of heaven here on earth. It's a land of more than enough for every area in our lives. A land of abundance. Man, I want that. I want to live that right here. You know, there's so many Christians. Oh, I can't wait till the rapture happens. You know what? I can wait. Not to say that I don't want to go be with the Lord. Yes, I want to go be with the Lord. But you know what? I don't want my family to be left behind. I don't want my children to be left behind. There's still so much more work that needs to be done. And the Lord has to be patient. Yeah. Man, one of the guys went in there. He said, he goes, man, would you spare them? If it was just one, how many? 10. He kept going. He goes, I'll spare them. You know what? How come we're not praying that in these days? Man, Lord, we need more time, Lord. You know, everybody else is saying that you're coming soon. I believe that you're coming soon, but we need more time, God. I have faith that we need more time. Man, they can't be left by the wayside, church. They can't be left by the wayside. You know, how many of us here this morning want our relationship with God to be on a promised land level? Our prayer life, our devotion to God to be on another level, a promised land level. You know what? I want my prayer life to be on a promised land level. Man, I didn't go learn at Pastor Ray's to be discipled right there, kicking and bucking at the altar, saying, you know what? I hate praying. I don't want to pray. I don't want to do this. Why? Because I was crucifying the flesh at that altar. Man, I needed the spirit man to come alive. I needed to be filled with faith, and I wanted to go to that promised land level that when I pray for my family's healing, they're healed. Yeah. You know what? I ain't got time for playing games. If you believe we're living in the last days, we got to get to that promised land level faith, church. Woo! Man, we got to be like the Smith Wigglesworths in the days. Man, y'all don't know nothing about little Smitty. Amen. Smitty was a crazy man for Jesus. Amen. Rise you up in the corner right out of a casket and tell you to rise up and walk and to come back to life in the name of Jesus. And he didn't care if your lifeless body was slumping over. He picked you up and tried again. Don't have no give up in you. You gotta give up, you know, you gotta give a fight, church. You gotta put up a fight in these last days. It's harder than ever to win souls. It was easy back in the days, man. There were so many gimmicks, man. I could go buy a pair of Jordans and a jersey. I get every kid from Brighton to come to our youth group. Amen. I'm giving away Jordans and jerseys. Huh? We got pizza. We got this. You know what? We want to offer, you know what, our youth all of the world just to get them in the church. It's backwards. Man, we got to get into that promised land experience, and we got to begin praying these youth into the church. We got to pray these families into the church, and we got to have faith and not give up. We got to hold on to it and pull it from the supernatural and release it into the physical. What are you holding on to, church? You know, I want you to say multiplier. Are you a multiplier? Say it. Say multiplier. I'm a multiplier in the kingdom business, man. I'm a multiplier. I don't play on even fields. You know what? It ain't about being equal. I'm a multiplier. You know what? I multiply disciples. I bring people in for the glory of God. I'm multiplying my faith. I'm increasing my faith. I'm fanatical. You know what? It ain't going to change. You can't stop me. How bad do you want it, church? Now, we got to get fanatical for Jesus. Now, when you're feeling like you're being, you know, pulled and you're struggling and you're tossed, you know what? You got to get into that throne room, that promised land, you know, level. You got to say, you know what, Lord? Increase my faith. And you got to hold on. But in order to do these things, we must start with God's will. It's all got to be with God's will, because if it ain't God's will, it ain't gonna line up to nothing. It ain't going to work. Amen. In Mark chapter 11, verses 23 through 24. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Check this out. For assuredly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be moved and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you will receive them and you will have them. Do you believe, church? Do you believe, church? Amen. That's the faith we need. Is that mountain gone yet? Faith to move a mountain. We read that scripture, you know what, and we sing the song, if I have faith to move a mountain, faith to move a mountain. Is that mountain gone yet, church? Because if you're praying for something in the supernatural and that mountain hasn't been removed, then you need to ask God to increase your faith. Why? Because you don't have the faith that you thought you had. He's telling us here something. You know what? It's impossible, basically, to see a mountain be removed. How many of you guys have been to the mountains lately? Amen? How many of you guys prayed to the mountain up there to be moved? He said, move us, right? Move me, Lord. Shake me, Lord. What about that mountain? What about that trial? That obstacle that's been hindering you, amen, from going above and beyond with the Lord, amen, increasing your faith. It's been causing you from your faith to grow because that mountain is ever before you, because you keep speaking to this mountain, but you don't have the faith that you need to have that mountain removed. Go with me to Matthew 4:4. Check this out. Man, I believe that these mountains are going to be... Man, you know, you don't feel me here this morning, do you, church? I told you that God spoke to me over 4.5 years ago when he brought us here. I seen the building. I seen the church. It's mine. Amen. By faith, it's mine. It's there. I'm waiting. You know, that mountain's got to move. But I'm going to keep speaking to that mountain. Why? Because that mountain's got to give. That mountain's going to give. My faith isn't going to decrease. My faith is going to increase. And one day, that mountain's going to move. Why? Because my faith is building up inside of me. But he said, I answered and said, it is written. This is the will of God. If you want that mountain to move, you got to be doing it by the will of God. He says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You know what? Are we those Bible thumping believers that, you know, that people should be calling? Oh, he's a Bible thumper. Oh, he's a holy roller. He's a hallelujah. Huh? That's what they used to call my grandmas and them back in the day, because they always be hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So they call them the hallelujahs. Amen. The holy rollers, because when they got filled with the Holy Ghost, man, they were rolling from one side of the church to the other on the floor. Holy rollers, amen, hallelujah. Man, there was no shame in them. They had that faith that could move a mountain. They were living in the supernatural, not in the natural, church. You know what? We've become so accustomed to living in the natural. Why? Because they've made praise and worship so easy for us. The Holy Spirit ain't even in it. They put lights and fog machines to get you going. You know what? That ain't faith. You know what, I need to jump up and down. You know what, I need to feel the presence of God upon my life so he can increase my faith. It's got to be living inside of me. But it comes from every word of God. How much time are we spending in his word? You know, you can watch all the TV sermons you want, listen to it on the radio, but it ain't going to do the same as you picking up the word of God for yourself and letting the Lord speak to you. You got to have personal, intimate time with him, one-on-one time. God, this is what's going on, God. Man, I need you, God. I need you, God. And the more that you see God come through for you, the more that your faith is going to increase. Why? Because you see that you're serving a living God. Man, and just so you think I'm not joshing you, go with me to Deuteronomy 8:3. Check this out. This is New Testament. Same thing. Same thing from the Old Testament. So he humbled you. Check this out. Híjole, it's hard serving God. Why? Because pastor wants us to fast now. I don't like going on diets. By the way, put it on your calendar. Next week, we're going to fast for a week. Amen? We got to start fasting in this church again. Not running to the store so fast or Mickey D's so fast. So he humbled you and he allowed you to hunger. And how many of you know that when you're hungry, the next time that you're able to take a bite, it tastes that much better? It's like, that's so good. But I mean, you got to be hungry. Brother is always hungry over there. It always tastes good, he says. Man, but you got to go so hungry, man. You know what, man? It's just like the next time that you just, it's the most purest thing, like he says here. And it says, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know. You know, he allows you to go so hungry in the flesh, so that way in the spirit and the supernatural, you begin to cry out and you begin to get this manna and you begin to get a word from God. Amen. You begin to get that word from God that nobody knows. It comes straight from the Father, man. It's anointed. It's spiritual. It's supernatural. Is that you, God, speaking to me? Simon, that's me. It's a living God. Turn the page. Turn the page. Ah, you want to know more of me? Turn the page. Oh, man, you want to get stronger? Turn the page. Man, you want to get more faith? Turn the page. Turn the page. But you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. You know what? We go to church in repetition. We go to church in this carne. How many of us were up last night praying for the service this morning? Hallelujah. I don't know what you're going to do tomorrow, Lord, but I'm so excited to show up to church tomorrow. I don't know why I'm excited, because my flesh never gets excited. It's got to be my spirit inside. Why? Because I'm not feeding in Mickey D's or hot wings. Lord, right now, give me your word, that living word, Lord God. Let it proceed from your mouth. And what does it do? It gets you going, church. It gets you going like never before. But that's the will of God. The will of God is for you and I to live out this very word. Plain and simple. The will of God isn't to do what you and I want to do. The will of God is for us to allow Him to increase our faith. So that way when we read this word is no longer a book, but it becomes so living to us that, you know what, we have no other desire but to do what it says. To do what it says. If God said it, I believe it, and I'm going to do it. Amen? You know, Mark 11:24, we're going to read that again. Therefore, I say to you, whatever thing you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Do you believe, church? Yes. A man came to a service and he wanted to be healed. He went on to say that his arm had been fixed in a certain position for many years and could not move it. Asked him, you got any faith? What do you think the person's response was?
I got all kinds of faith.
He said, I have a lot of faith. And after prayer, he was able to move his arm around. But he was not satisfied and he complained. He said, I feel a little trouble there. And he started pointing to a certain place on his arm. And the preacher just stared at him. Imagine this. The preacher just stared at him. And he told him, you know what your problem is? And the guy said, no. And the preacher said, it's imperfect faith. There's so many Christians, you know what, that say they have faith, but they have an imperfect faith. It's not a complete faith. It's not a whole faith. It's a partial faith. You know what the Word of God says? Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. You know, with so many people, when they want to be healed, you know what? They forget about being specific. You know what? God, forgive me. Because I haven't been specific. You know, my prayer should be in faith, with an increasing faith. It should be like, you know what, God? You go into that leg right now, Lord God, where them pins and where them plates and everything are at, Lord God. And Lord, supernaturally, Lord God, you remove those plates from there, Lord God. And right now, Lord God, you will realign everything in that leg, Lord God, to conform to your will and rise up and walk. Don't complain. Just rise up and walk and thank God for that healing, that supernatural faith that He places inside of you. Amen. Because we could continue to go around and not do what we need to do and stand around. Amen. And think the way that we need to think. Or do we want to move on with faith? Do we want a supernatural faith in Jesus? Supernatural faith. It's imperfect. You know what? When God heals us, He heals us wholly. From the inside out, when He restores your marriage, He restores them completely. He just doesn't do it by steps. It's complete. You know, and that's the God that we have to serve. You know what? He does it like that, church. Did you believe before you were saved? Did you believe before you were saved? You know, so many people would be saved, but they want to feel saved first. There was never a man who felt saved before he believed. He had to believe first to be saved. You know, so many Christians, just like I shared with you right now, they want to feel all the stuff in between before they give their lives to God, before they go the extra step. And that's not what God says. He says, you know what? First believe. You got to have that faith. Do you believe that I can do what I say I can do? Do you believe that I'm a living God in your life? Do you believe that I filled you with the Holy Ghost? Do you believe that I'm empowering you? Do you believe? And I believe, church. I believe. I believe now more than ever. Why? Because, man, the more that I see God moving and the more that I see God doing, I have no choice but to believe because God is so good. You know, God's plan is always this. If you will believe, you shall see the glory of God. I believe that God wants to bring us all to a place of unwavering faith and the confidence in him like never before. You know what Jesus said? If you have faith to move a mountain. And why does he say a mountain? Because if faith can move a mountain, it can remove anything. If faith can remove a mountain, church, it can remove anything. That's the kind of faith that I want. I want that kind of faith, you know what, that can remove anything. You know what, Lord, I don't want to be a drug addict. I don't want to be in bondage to this and that. You know what, Lord, I believe that you can remove it. And with that faith, he removes it. You know what, Lord, I don't want to live like this anymore. And by faith, you know what, you tell him to remove those feelings of suicide and all them things. He removes it. But you got to have faith. You know, Matthew 19:26, but Jesus looked to them and said, to them, with men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. You know, whose eyes are we looking through? Who are we listening to? You know what I tell you? You know what? You look at a person and you see the five people that they surround themselves with. And you can tell what kind of faith that man has just by the five people he surrounds himself with. Man, I'm telling you, church, we need to start surrounding ourselves with people with like faith. Amen. Come on up here, Andrew. I want you to stand right here real quick. I want to show you something, church. Now, this is the kind of faith that we have to have. He's a strong guy. Man. Man. Yeah. He's pulling me, see?
Testing your leg.
Testing my leg. Oh, see, making sure. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus. This is the faith that we need to have. You know, when we're reaching into the supernatural, you know what? We got to grab on to the faith in that supernatural. And you're grabbing on to that faith in the supernatural, and you're calling it out of this mountain, be removed, and you're calling it from the supernatural, and it's pulling you back. But you're pulling it back, and it's pulling you back, and it's tugging you, but your faith is increasing, and the more that it's pulling you and trying to get you to go out, you got to pull it in to existence. You got to pull it into the natural. Why? Because it's right there for you, brother. He believes it in faith, and now he's going to pull his family in. He's going to pull them in from the supernatural to the natural. Why? Because in the supernatural, my family's saved. And you're going to see it on the natural. Why? Because I'm pulling them in by faith. Because I have a faith that goes above and beyond. Amen. Thank you, brother. Thank you, brother. A faith that goes above and beyond. In John 6:63. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and life. What are God's words? God's words are supernatural. Amen. They're heavenly. He spoke them into existence. They're from heaven. They're his words. These are supernatural words. And it gives life. Life. Why? Because the flesh profits nothing. Now, how many know you go to work all day and you get tired, right? Yeah. Man, you make a, you, I don't even want to say what you make. I don't even know what you make. But I feel like when I used to go to work, I go work my butt off and Uncle Sam took everything else and I was done with the dollar to wipe after. Man, I said, what's going on here? But the Spirit gives life. You know what, Lord? I don't need a cheeseburger. Obviously. But I could use some more of your word. Man, the Bible deals so much with this, you know what I mean? And it all has to boil down to commitment. Why? Because without commitment, you can't have faith. You got to be committed and you can't waver, so that way your faith can increase, church. And as your faith increases, you gotta understand that the word that I speak to you are spirit and they're life. You know what, Lord? I don't want to see what your word, you know, I could see what happens, you know what I mean, on the outside, but I want to see what your word does in the supernatural. And as it begins to do in the supernatural, as I see it, let it take birth in the physical, Lord. Why? So that way I can appreciate it and comprehend it more. You know, so many people get launched out, or so many people have a calling in their life and they go at it, but they forget. They forget where it's supposed to come from, where the gift came from the beginning. It came from the supernatural. It came from God's very word. It's God's. It's not ours. You know, I don't want people, you know, like I always say, oh, we should put a billboard up. We should do signs. We should. I said, no, I don't want my face to be all over. Why? Because I don't want people to come see me. I want people to come because they want to come because of Jesus, or because they want, you know, they want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Not because of a person. Not because of an evangelist, because he's all TV famous. Everybody wants to come. You know, there's a lot of things that people who go to church that, you know, that they don't see the things that go on behind the scenes. When I was a youth pastor, at New Hope Ministries of Denver, we had an individual that came from Texas. He was a big time pastor. He preached at all these mega churches, and I had to take him to go do a video shoot at this other church, the Potter's House. They're a big church. Man, we walked in there. I was like, man, this is kind of cool. Walk in there, they have security and everything, you know what? Put your hands up in the air, beep, 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 beep. Okay, you're cool, you go in. I mean, so you walk up and I was like, man, this is cool. We got all the offices, you know what I mean? Nah, this is legit. Then we go back to the video room, man. It was like a huge, like three gymnasiums. And they all had different like sceneries and backgrounds with cameras to set, you know, shoot different sceneries and all that. And I started listening to the guy that I took over there. He was talking to the pastor. He was like, yeah, he goes, you remember when I called you like 5 years ago? He goes, and you shut me down? He's like, yeah. He goes, what was it? He goes, do you remember what you told me? He says, yeah, I remember exactly what I told you. He goes, you need to build up your resume more. He said, because you don't generate enough money to come to this church, to come speak at this church. See, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for faces. Looking for all those guys out there. You know, everybody knows them because they see them. They think that these guys are really cool and all this. You know what I mean? And they could be, you know, cool guys. But a lot of them are feeding you with a bunch of garbage. You know what? They're teaching you how to survive off the flesh. And they're not teaching you about the spiritual things, church. You know, we can't survive off the flesh. We got to survive off the very word of God, man. That's the bread, man. That's exactly what we need. You know, in Acts chapter 2, verses 38 through 39. Check it out. You got to be willing to be obedient. This is how our faith increases as well. He says, then Peter said to them, nobody likes to hear this, repent! Repent! And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the what? The gift of the Holy Spirit. I want to share this with you real quick. And you can get mad at me if you want. I really don't care. Because I love you anyways. Did these guys go down to the River Jordan? I had a phone call the other day on baptisms. I said, whoa, hold up. I said, we don't mind doing baptisms. We love doing baptisms. We'll probably do them here shortly. I was like, I go, but it's just like communion. I said, I go, we don't put an emphasis on, you know what, doing communion and the baptisms all the time. Why? I go, because it's an outside thing. I said, it's like, you know what, taking a shower and just cleaning off your skin, you know what, and you go out there and get all dirty again and come back to take another shower. It really didn't mean anything. I said, in the book of Acts, Jesus says, he says to wait for the promise, because he says, you know what, he goes, I'm gonna baptize you, not in water, but I'm gonna baptize you with the Holy Ghost. I have nothing against water baptisms. We'll do them, you know what I mean, for families to see or whatnot. But don't put so much emphasis on the natural and the physical and the carne and begin realizing that the God we serve is a supernatural God, and he wants us to do things in the Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Filled with the Spirit. Amen? You know, if you're willing and obedient, things will happen. Let's go on. He says, for the promise is to you and your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Basically going, you know what? Works ain't going to get you to heaven. You can do all these things, but you know what? If you ain't filled with the Holy Ghost, if you ain't got that promise that Jesus told you, you can get baptized in water. You know what? You can come cry at these altars, but if you truly ain't repenting, if you truly ain't laying it down before the Lord, if you truly ain't sincere, amen, if you truly don't believe in God's promise and have faith, it ain't never going to happen. You got to be obedient. And when you're obedient, you get to eat of the good of the land. When you're obedient, you get to eat of the good of the land. You know, what type of faith do you have? And what is it that you see? And who is it that you believe? The Lord did something amazing for his people in Numbers chapter 13, verses 26 through 28. Check this out, church. How many of you like grapes? Numbers 13. Verse 26 through 28. Sorry. Check this out, church. Now they departed and came back to Moses. Man, I always like to go back to Moses, man. We get a good illustration of people that do not have faith. People who complain. People who live by the carne instead of, you know what, the Spirit. But check it out. He says, and they came back to Moses and Aaron and the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran and Kadesh. They brought back word to them. Go on. And to all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. How many know that God says that he'll give us, you know, things that are plenteous? You know what? First of all, they didn't even have to go to spy out that land to begin with. God didn't tell them to go check it out. He did it. But the carne wants to be nosy and wants to go check it out, eh? Let me go check it out over there, you see? And then they get over there and they say, oh, man. Well, those people over there, man, they speak in tongues and they jump up and down and they do all these things. It's plenteous. And they bring back forth the word. Why? Because they seen it in the spiritual. But their faith never increased. Their faith stood level. So they went out and they seen that, and they're like, man, God is good. God didn't send them, but they went anyways. You know what? Just to show, oh, yeah, well, this is how good God is. And he showed them. Now let's go on. He says, then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Man, this is God. This God can do what he says he can do. You know what? God is faithful. Let's go on. He says, nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. Man, why are you looking at people for? Amen. Oh, man, brother must be filled with the Holy Ghost. You see him jumping up and down and speaking in tongues. So what? Why aren't you jumping up and down speaking in tongues? Why are you looking at brother when you should be doing it? He says, man, they were nevertheless the people who dwell in the land are strong, looking at the people. Always looking at the people instead of what God can do. You know, I know what people can do. I know what I can do, you know what, when I put my hands to it. But what can God do in and through me if I let God do it? If I let God increase my faith? It says the cities are fortified. Oh, man, they don't have enough classrooms in there. We have plenty of classrooms in here. I see a nursery right there. I see a kid's one right there. He got there. We can make some outside. Put up a couple canopies and some of them big old jet fans that blow air with water to keep them cool. There you go. How many more rooms you want? I ain't looking in the physical. I'm looking at the supernatural. Amen. Man, they're a bunch of little changos anyways that could climb the tree. They're very large. I don't know how we're going to do it, Pastor. I don't know how many times I got to talk people off the ledge. Stop it. Stop being so negative. Oh, I don't have enough. I can't do it. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Stop thinking like that. Have faith. Tiene faith. Amen. You got faith. Faith. Hey. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The giants. Everybody was scared of the giants. Hey. And everybody over here, oh, man, I saw El Chapo at King Supers. He escaped again. But his wife's getting locked up now. Pray for her. You know, she could be all tough on the outside with, like, you know, that she's all, you know, she's shaking in her boots, man. Man, that woman ain't never knew nothing but the glamorous life, man. El Chapo paid for everything for her, man. Fancy cars, jewelry, money to no expense. And now she's going to go to prison for following some idiot. Yeah, El Chapo. I might get shot because his people might come looking for me now. Call them an idiot. But the descendants of Anak are there. Anak are there. You know, we always look to the past. You know, how many of us, you know, we need our faith to increase, but we're so stuck in the past, man. We're so, oh, well, this is over there, that's over there, this happened. You know, so what? What about now? What's going to happen now? What's going to go as we move forward? Man, pastor said this, and it never happened. I'm not a prophet. I never say nothing like that. Man, I said, pastor said, you know, we want to start a youth group, but it never happened. Why? Because I can't be the youth pastor. I got to be the pastor of the church. You know what? I can't be the nursery. I can't be that. I can't be the drummer because, man, y'all, none of you would come to church if I was the drummer. But praise God. Amen. You know what? Proverbs 23, verse 7. We're getting close here. I got a couple more verses and we can get you out of here today so you guys could beat the Baptist to the buffet. Amen. Proverbs 23, 7, brother. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Who do you think you are? And I'm not talking about the sarcastic one. Who do you think you are? Huh? I'm not saying somebody else telling you who do you think you are. I'm telling yourself, who do you think you are? You're speaking to yourself right now. You know, who do you think you are? For as he thinks in his heart, so he is. Man, I remember when I stopped telling myself, you know what, that I was no good, that I am somebody in Christ Jesus, that things began to change for me in my life. Was it immediate? No, it was gradual. Why? Because God had to increase my faith. Man, God can't just give me a faith all the way up here. Man, I'd just probably go crazy. I know what I did with a big old sack of dope. I went crazy. You know what I mean? I got to be careful. God's got to give me in rations because I'll go crazy. Little bit. Increase it, Lord, little by little. And I began to think about who I was. Why? Because the more that I thought about the Lord, the less I thought about myself. The more that I began to read God's word, the less I began to see who I was in the past, and the more that I began to see who I was moving forward with God. You know, and every time, you know what, that I began to see it, my heart began to change, because my heart was softened because of God's word and through prayer. And that's what I seen. You know what? I don't see that old person anymore. I see that new person. And man, it hurts, because I don't like to sympathize sometimes, because I'm a man. You know what? I like to... be macho. People know I'm crying and this and that, but nah. The more that I began to allow God into my heart, I began to see who I was. More genuine, more compassionate, more loving, more caring, more sincere. I was a toothless bear, a gummy bear. Ready to nibble and gnaw at everything, amen. In 2 Corinthians 5:7, you have to understand something, church, that this is your faith. My faith is my faith, and your faith is your faith. It says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. You can't live off of my faith, your parents' faith. You have to go and have your own faith. You know what? The pastor could tell you, you should go to church and you should go to prayer, but you know what? Until you let God increase your faith, you're never going to make it to church, and you're never going to make it to prayer as often as you should. You know what? Until you ask God to increase your faith in certain areas of your life, you're never going to be faithful and committed in that area of your life. You're always going to make an excuse for why you do what you do. Man, it's just a faithless life. I don't want to have a faithless life. A faithless life is a powerless life. And why is faith so important? It's because faith deals with the spiritual realm. That's why faith is so important. Without faith, you can't believe in God. Without faith, this word can't change you. The Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please Him. It's impossible. Do you receive it, church? Do you receive it? Amen. Receive it means to take it. Just like the illustration that I shared with brother, to take it. Come up here again, brother. To take it. We had a shirt that we used to make back here at New Hope Ministries. And it had a big pit bull on the shirt. And it said, Pit Bull Faith. You know, that's the kind of faith that we need, brother. We need a pit bull faith. We need that lockjaw type of faith, that when we grab on to that supernatural realm, when we're grabbing onto it, we don't let go. We start foaming at the mouth. It's mine. I'm not letting it go. It's a pit bull faith. That's what you got to have for your marriages. That's what you got to have for your kids. That's what you got to have for your brothers and sisters. That's what you got to have for your healing. That's the kind of faith that you got to have. A pit bull faith. I'm not letting go. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Take it. Take that pit bull faith. You know what? Who are you in Christ Jesus? What kind of faith do you have? Stand with me here today, church. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know what? The Lord's going to meet you at this altar today, church. He's already here. You know what that need is. And all I'm doing is I'm just opening this altar to that specific need. Because everybody has different needs. But one of those main needs that we need is we need a pit bull faith this morning, church. If you feel the Holy Spirit tugging at your heart, if you feel God right now moving in you like never before, that He wants you just to make a move, I want you to step out from where you're at, and I want you to make your way to this altar, church. Why? Because God's going to meet you right here. He's going to meet you here this morning. Oh, yandaraya baba sitiriya sai. Yes.
Come on, let the sound of worship be released from your lips tonight. Come on, raise it now. Oh, that's good, y'all. Raise it. Lift your hands at this
altar. He's here. I want you to begin speaking to him right now, this morning. Man, there's nothing to be ashamed of.
Sacrifice.
God, I can lay hands on you, church. But the whole
the dry bones respond, I gotta run over. Till cancer responds, I gotta run over. Till my family responds, I gotta run over. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Fill me up till I overflow. Come on. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Say, fill me up till I overflow. I wanna run.